Welcome, everybody, to Radicalized Truth Survives, episode 119. My name is Heidi Kuda, and today Jim and Hi-Fi have the honor of interviewing Professor Marci Shore. She is an intellectual history professor at Yale University and also the author of The Ukrainian Night, An Intimate History of Revolution. And we are going to be talking about how we in America need to cross over to the other side of fear. Have a listen. Welcome to RadPod, Marci Shore. We are so excited that you are here with us today. I just was telling the guys that my eyes are all puffy because I read your book through the night and I cried the whole time. We really are so grateful for your expertise and all the work that you've done to tell these stories. And where we would love to start with you when we're talking about the Ukrainian night is, can we sort of begin in what we might have missed in the 1990s that led up to 2004 and ultimately the events of 2014? Because I think that is something that's often overlooked and not talked about enough.
Yes, absolutely. I'm happy to begin wherever you'd like. And thank you so much for inviting me. Historians, as you might guess, have a kind of infinite regression problem because at any given moment in time, where we are is conditioned by what came before that. You know, so there's no such thing as starting with a tabula rasa. There's no such thing as a pure beginning point because we're always already somewhere in circumstances and in conditions that have been created by what from what happened before. You know, so I always have this tendency to like, well, in order to understand 2013, you have to understand 2004. In order to understand 2004, you have to understand 1991. And it just keeps going. So we can start anywhere you like in that sense. We might as well start, I suppose, with the breakup of the Soviet Union, which is 1991, although that really only makes sense in the context of 1989 and the collapse of communism in Eastern Europe and the fall of the Berlin Wall. And that what I would emphasize here is that it was something that most people never thought they could imagine seeing in their lifetimes until the very moment that it happened. And there's a historical lesson there, which is that many things seem absolutely impossible until the moment when they happen, and then they retrospectively seem inevitable. I try to keep that in mind sometimes when I'm feeling, you know, most despairing of the state of the world. That was what everyone was telling me, regardless of what side they had been on and what they had done or not done during the communist period. When I got there in the early 1990s, people kept saying, we never thought we would see an end in our lifetime. The Soviet Union was supposed to last forever, and then suddenly it was over. And another thing I would emphasize here, both for people of younger generation who don't remember the Soviet Union, and even for those of us who do, is that it was the largest, most far-reaching, deepest, penetrating, grandest scale social engineering experiment ever performed on mankind. We are still in some ways coming to terms with the sheer scale of the experiment and the sheer scale of the catastrophe. It was in many ways unprecedented. It was an attempt not just to remake a government and not even just to remake a society. It was an attempt to re-engineer human beings on a massive, massive scale. Nobody knew what was going to happen when that fell apart. Nobody knew. And the Soviet Union, as it falls apart, you know, various things happen. One is that there were 15 constituent republics, the largest of which was the Russian Soviet Republic. They get their independence or quasi-independence. Some fight harder, like in particular the Baltic states. Ukraine does not fight for its independence. It chooses it in a referendum, but it's essentially handed to it Independence is handed to Ukraine as the result of the breakup of the Soviet Union. Nobody yet knows exactly what that's going to mean. It was a popular choice throughout the territory of what had been the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic, but it was an unprecedented occurrence, and nobody really knew what it was going to be like to have their own state. But this was true, you know, for many other people and places. On the one hand, and through the 1990s, you have the narrative that was in some ways dominant on both sides of the Iron Curtain, which was the Francis Fukuyama end of history narrative, which was essentially the replacement of one Hegelian narrative with another Hegelian narrative. So instead of history leading inevitably, inexorably towards a communist utopia, now history was going to proceed inevitably, inexorably towards liberal democracy. And liberal democracy, which is conceived as a kind of utopian capitalist package in which you have liberalism, democracy, free market, neoliberalism, and a kind of unproblematic, harmonious whole. And okay, not everybody was there yet, and there were going to be some bumps on the road. And we had to get through this transition, you know, transition and transitology, where the words of the moment, that was the field of the moment, how do you transition from communism to capitalism? But the idea was essentially that there was a liberal teleology of progress. Now the locomotive was on the right track, and we were all going to end up there. So there was that cheerful optimism that in many ways took hold on both sides of the former Iron Curtain. Now, at the same time, in post-Soviet Ukraine, like in other post-Soviet parts of the former Soviet Union, which was all of it, really, you have an attempt to move from an economy in which everything is owned by the state to which things are privately owned. I'm no expert on this topic. I've never understood economics well, but the short version of the story is that the people who were apparatchiks and highly placed in the communist regime were in a particularly good position to steal the resources during privatization. And so you have the emergence of what you could call robber baron capitalism, going back to a 19th century precedent, or kleptocratic oligarchy, both of those things, a kind of wild free-for-all, whereas capitalism means you can exploit anyone as much as you want and there aren't any rules, and the people who were well-positioned in the previous regime get to consolidate a lot of the resources. And so you have what my political scientist colleagues had named the blackmail state, what they called Ukraine in 1991. And it was kind of languishing in this kind of emergence of kleptocratic oligarchy, massive poverty through this transition. Most people were losers of the transition. You know, suddenly, how do you go from soft currency to hard currency? Suddenly your salary is worth nothing. Suddenly prices shoot up. You know, suddenly a pension is worth absolutely nothing. How are you possibly going to survive? So you have a lot of crime and different kinds of crime you had before. And so the 1990s were not a happy time. And this is something I would emphasize that we in the quote unquote West failed to recognize. And I think only slowly, even though I was hanging out in Eastern Europe, came to recognize that we were seeing this through this prism of a cheerful liberal teleology of progress in which the wicked witch is dead and we were all moving towards happily ever after, even if there were some bumps. But for most people who were in these transition societies, it was kind of miserable. You were just struggling to survive. If you were older and you had already made life choices, you were in no position to take advantage of the new freedoms you've been given, you know, and all of your security had just been pulled out from under you. So Ukraine kind of languished in this state, you know, until eventually you have this election of 2004. You know, so you have a lot of corruption. You have massive corruption and kleptocracy and the emergence of oligarchy. And then in 2004, you have this election between the two victors. This is, of course, confusing because there are otherwise, you know, Slavic names that are hard for non-Slavic speakers to remember. And both guys are named Victor. But you have the one victor who is Viktor Yanukovych, who was the kind of post-Soviet from the Donbas gangster, Kremlin ally type. And then there was Viktor Yushchenko, who seemed to be the more westward looking, enlightened, let's try to integrate into Europe guy. And the very short version of that presidential election is that Yanukovych's team tries to, and in fact does, poison Yushchenko with dioxin. The doctors, I think in Vienna, if I'm recalling correctly, managed to save him, but his face is horribly disfigured. And that disfigured face becomes an icon of post-Soviet corruption and dirty politics. You know, and in addition to doing that before the eyes of the whole world, there are fairly obvious attempts to forge the election results. So this is November 2004. At that point, Ukrainians go out onto the streets. In particular, they go to the Majdan, which is the big square in the center of Kiev, and they protest. They protest, they demand free elections. And extraordinarily enough, after 3 weeks of freezing and protesting and no violence whatsoever, this works with some intervention from various other European political figures. The elections are held over. You know, this time Yushchenko is declared the winner. Everybody is happy and they go home. And the thought is that now we're going to live happily ever after. And as you probably guessed, the short version of that story is that people don't live happily ever after, that Yushchenko, for whatever combination of reasons, turns out to be disappointment. Whether he never was the messiah figure he was presumed to be, whether because of infighting on his staff and the falling out with Yulia Tymoshenko, whether because the democratic structures were not sufficiently in place from below, for whatever, whether he was never the same after the dioxin poisoning, for whatever reason, it doesn't turn out well. There's a lot of disillusionment. And in the meantime, Yanukovych, who it would have seemed would be impossible for him to come back. I mean, this guy has not only lost the election, but it has been exposed that he tried to poison his opponent with dioxin and he forged the election results. So you would think he's really out of it, but he's still lurking behind the scenes, which is even more remarkable because there's nothing remarkable about him. He's not particularly clever. He's not particularly bright. He doesn't have any kind of utopian eschatological ideology that he is selling to the country. He's just unapologetically, nakedly a gangster. I mean, the only thing he's got going is that like the next gangster could be worse. I'm the gangster, you know. But in the meantime, he's kind of lurking in the background and he finds out that across the ocean in Washington, you've got this little niche boutique industry of PR experts for gangsters with presidential ambitions. So he hires one of these guys who doesn't speak Russian, doesn't speak Ukrainian, but flies over to Kiev and goes golfing with him and teaches him some television tricks, gets him a new haircut, a new suit. I wasn't paying that close attention, but personally, I didn't see much of a difference. But this guy gets remade from his fancy Washington PR agent, whose name, by the way, is Paul Manafort. Some of you may have heard of him.
So
you see how these stories start to get connected. And Yanukovych comes back in 2010, this time legitimately to win the presidential election. And this time nobody disputes the results. At that point, he gives his PR assistant or consultant as a thank you gift, a $30,000 jar of caviar. I don't even know what one does with a $30,000 jar of caviar, but I say this as somebody who doesn't actually like caviar. In any case, Paul Manafort gets his fancy jar of caviar, which of course is another symbol of this sort of post-Soviet corruption. Yanukovych is in power. He's being his usual self. He's generally beholden to the Kremlin. If people are too critical, they might be taken away. It's dangerous to be an opposition journalist, but there's no large-scale mass repression towards the population in general. He's making vague symbolic gestures as a kind of carrot to the opposition and to the young generation that maybe someday there'll be European integration. And that's the carrot that he is dangling, to the many Ukrainians who don't like him. And there's this agreement that is finally due in 2013 to be signed with the European Union. It's an association agreement, not a membership agreement. It's not fantastic. It involves Ukraine undertaking costly reforms, certainly would provoke retaliation from the Kremlin, who does not want Ukraine integrating into Europe. And at the end of the day, does not promise that if Ukraine is very good, Ukraine will be given EU membership. Nevertheless, although it's not an explicit guarantee, the symbolism is there that it's a foot in the door, you know, that it's a sign that, you know, Ukraine is going to make an effort to move towards European standards, and that Europe, if only provisionally and conditionally, might be willing to accept Ukraine. And how important this was to you depended radically on your position in society. If you were 70 years old and living in Eastern Ukraine and retired and never even thinking you were going to cross the border all the way west into Europe and not having any money or language skills to do so anyway, this was not a particularly big deal to you. If you were 18 years old and starting university, it was everything. Whether or not Europe would be open to you, whether or not you would be eligible for Erasmus exchanges, would you be able to study abroad? Would you be able to learn foreign languages? Would you be able to do internships in Brussels, go to conferences without humiliating yourself, standing in line for days pleading for a visa and being treated like a second-class human being? You know, was the world going to be open to you? Could you work for international organizations? Could you work for international businesses? It was your whole future. So there was a very strong generational component to this. I mean, it was not only people talk about East Ukraine and West Ukraine at that time, but more profoundly, it may probably had to do with generations.
Thank you so much for that. I know I've learned so much just in listening to how you sort of explain the origins, you know, beginning from the time period where we just started, because obviously Paul Manafort played a big role in our current situation. So it's all incredibly important. And when we talk about your book, The Ukrainian Night, An Intimate History of Revolution, the way you tell the story is so beautiful through poets and musicians and their parents. And it's really just an incredibly beautiful story. But the thing that I lost my train of thought because I'm like trying not to cry again. Okay. So when we talk about the Ukrainian night and this intimate history of revolution, there's this moment where somebody posts on Facebook and says, likes don't count. And for me, that was such an important moment because we all have been fighting on the virtual battlefield, but we are not seeing what we're seeing in Georgia happening in America. We are not seeing what happened in 2014 in Ukraine happening in America, despite how dire our election outcome was, involving many of the same people that you know, were involved in what happened in Ukraine. And why was it so important that there was that moment where somebody says, "You likes don't count, like you've got to show up and you got to do this in person"?
That was extraordinary. And it was one of those moments that reveals what historians like to call contingency. Because that was, so it was November 13th. And what happens is that Yanukovych, the association agreement has already been agreed on. There's a signing ceremony prepared in Vilnius. It's all seems to be a done deal. And then at the 11th hour, under pressure from Putin, Yanukovych suddenly says, "I'm not going to sign." And at that point, there's a sense of despair. But the question, I think the question you're asking is, what determines when that despair turns into action? You know, and how contingent is that? And I think it's very possible that not much might have happened had it not been for the fact that this 32-year-old, then 32-year-old, Afghan-Ukrainian journalist named Mustafa Nayem post on Facebook, in Russian, by the way, you know, a little message saying, "Hey, let's be serious. You know, if you're really upset, come out to the Majdan, this big square in the center of Kiev, by midnight tonight. Likes do not count." And I was fascinated by that, likes do not count, because it was so provocative, and it was a sentence that would have meant nothing before Facebook. It would have literally been meaningless. And now it's going to be a slogan for revolution in the 21st century. And it was about, you know, what my friend Vasil Cherepanim, who appears in that book, calls corporeal politics. You know, and by that, he doesn't mean that politics has to be violent, but it does mean that you've got to show up, exactly as you said. You've got to show up in person, physically, with your body. And people came to the Majdan. People came to the Majdan, largely but not exclusively young people, students. They were not interested in ethnic politics. They weren't interested in language politics. They weren't interested in religious differences. They weren't interested in opposition parties. Their whole thing was Ukraine is Europe. That's it. Ukraine is Europe. They held hands. They sang. They danced. It was perfectly peaceful. People from all different kind of walks of life, but generationally very young. And again, like it was November, it was getting colder and colder, you know, that could have just kind of worn away, as inevitably most protests do, because nobody has infinite energy. Had not Yanukovych, again, it seems under pressure from Putin, decided on the night of November 30th at 4 a.m. that he was going to end this thing. He was going to send his riot police, these thugs out there, to brutally beat up the students. And it seems he was counting on the fact that that kind of large-scale violence against the population had not been used in Ukraine since 1991. You know, there had been journalists found dead. There had been individual figures assassinated. But this large-scale violence against peaceful protesters, that had been a taboo. And it seems he was counting on the fact that you break that taboo, you shock people, and the parents are going to freak out and they're going to pull their kids off the streets, which was perhaps not an irrational calculation. But watching, I was in Vienna at the time, I was only watching the stream, I wasn't there. But the extraordinary thing was that instead of pulling their kids off the streets, the parents joined them there. And so many revolutions historically are implauded as Oedipal rebellions. You have each generation rising up against the fathers in their turn. That's the stereotypical trope. And it's not necessarily inaccurate. And here you have this kind of Hegelian Aufhebung, this kind of Hegelian, you know, overcoming of Oedipal rebellion, and the parents join their kids on the streets. And then they're not just shouting, Ukraine is Europe. Now it's, we will not permit you to beat our children. You know, and now you go from something that was about EU integration into something that's much broader, something that is impassioned protest, you know, against being the victims of arbitrary violence at the hands of the regime.
Wow, Jim.
First of all, wow, thank you so much. Just wonderful to listen to you talk. A really important history for our listeners. I am just because of what I do, extremely interested in the parallels between historical events and what's happening right now. I see basically an authoritarian fascist takeover of the United States happening. And based on what I see as a new oligarchy in America, similar to the, you know, sort of robber barons of old, and then the oligarchs of Russia coming to power, it seems to me that if this regime is successful, we will end up in some sort of an authoritarian regime, which will require a kind of U.S. Majdan at some point. And I'm obviously speculating, and I'm just thinking ahead because of where we are. I was just wondering, what are your thoughts about the parallels between the repression that Ukraine was under and the repression that's being promised to us, right? That's already being told to us by the selections of the cabinet members, the promises of retribution, all of those things. I don't mean to put you on the spot. I know that's not exactly what the book is about, but I was curious about your reflections on Ukraine then and the US now and in the near future.
Yeah. I'm completely terrified. Maybe I feel like in some ways the past 8 years could be subtitled Vindication of the Neurotic Catastrophist. Like,
Thank you.
I consider myself an erotic catastrophist.
You win. Okay, thank you so much for that.
No, there's
we should start a club.
Neurotic catastrophist night. I love it. So
I did not really want to be vindicated in this. There's yeah. an aphorism in Polish, which in translation is, I found myself at the very bottom, but then I heard knocking from below. I feel like I've noticed that the Russians abbreviate this expression to just knocking from below, and everyone understands what you mean. And I feel like that's been coming up again and again. You think it couldn't get any worse. And then it turns out that I would go back to 2016 or really even 2015. And again, like I'm a hardcore neurotic. You know, I come from an American Jewish family. Like, guilt is omnipresent. We're always on the edge of disaster. That's my basic character trait. But I already had this feeling of terror from the time of the first Republican primary debates. And I remember this because I was actually in Kiev. And this is how these stories come together for me. I was in Kiev, and it was late. It was fall of 2015, and it must have been after the first or the second Republican primary debate when Trump had just appeared on the scene. I hadn't been aware of his presence before, and I don't think anyone was then taking seriously the possibility that he would actually take power. But I had this terror, like this feeling of terror, and I was doing an interview for with a Ukrainian journalist before this panel discussion we had. And I remember her asking me in Russian, the way that she phrased the question was, who in America at this moment would you not shake hands with? Would you not give your hand to? And I said, Donald Trump. You know, before I knew, but there was something about his performance in that first debate and his pulling out of the air, like, oh, I wouldn't make parents vaccinate their kids. Vaccinations cause autism. I don't know whether he believed it. He didn't believe it. It didn't really matter. My kids were small at the time, but I had this sense of unhinging and irresponsibility that must have seemed like an appealing populist thing to say. And it's one thing if you say it to your friend at a bar at 3 a.m, but if you say it as a presidential candidate on national television, some 100,000 more parents are not going to vaccinate their kids, and some non-trivial percentage of those kids are going to die. You know, and nobody was holding him responsible. You know, philosophers of language would call that asymmetrical authority. It's not just like you have a right to freedom of speech, you say this to your friend. You say this in this context and kids are going to die. Not your kids, but somebody else's kids. And I had this sense that people were going to die, that you would have this unhinging. And if I understood faster than most Americans that something terrifying was going on, it's not because I was any smarter, but because I had been watching what was happening in Russia and Ukraine. And so you see how this kind of unhinging from empirical reality can be connected to this total absence of any kind of responsibility, this falling of a kind of free-for-all, you know, this Dostoevskian, everything is permitted, there is no more rules. So I was terrified very early, and that was very much inflected by my, you know, Slavicist world. And I felt like the day after the elections in 2016, you know, suddenly everybody I knew, even being in a bubble, kind of divided into a little bit into two camps. And I would say, like, my Slavicist and East Europeanist friends, and then my other American friends and colleagues. Nobody I knew was happy about it. I didn't actually have anyone on that side. But there were a lot of my Americanist friends and colleagues, or who were not even American, some were Americanist as a profession and some were just Americans, saying, okay, bad, this is very bad, but we're going to get through it. We're going to be okay. We are the world's strongest liberal democracy. We drink in our liberalism with our mother's milk. We have checks and balances. And checks and balances became like a yoga mantra. It was like, breathe in, checks and balances, breathe out, checks and balances, you know, it's going to be okay. And then there were, like, my Slavicist friends who were wrapped up in what was going on in Eastern Europe, saying things like, this is my interpretation of their general sentiment, we're like people on the Titanic saying our ship can't sink. You know, other ships can sink, but, like, we've got, like, the best ship, we've got the fanciest ship, we've got the newest ship. you know, and as a historian, and especially as a historian of this catastrophically in place like Eastern Europe, you know that there is no such thing as a ship that cannot sink.
Wow.
Thank you.
Wow.
Exactly what I was
looking for. Yes, high fidelity.
I'm sorry, I don't have something more cheerful to say.
No.
Our show is not about hopium or cheering people up. It's about telling the truth. So thank you.
Telling the truth and inspiring action, useful, nonviolent, you know, ways to fight back. High fidelity.
So I just have a question. Why do people learn history and not learn from history? Because, well, here's my problem. And Heidi and I were discussing this earlier today. In 1933, we had the business plot here in the United States where, you know, billionaires and millionaires attempted to overthrow FDR and the New Deal and deliver us under, you know, Nazi sympathies. We then arrested foreign agents and stripped them of their citizenship and deported them. Hey, that was great. We still had fascism. We still had communism. We still had the fall of the USSR. Not USSR. Now we're seeing Russia attempting things in Moldova, dirty tricks in Lithuania. We see what's going on in Georgia. Mm-hmm. We know that Russia is behind Trump. We know that Saudi Arabia is behind Trump. We know all of this. And yet we are not doing anything. Why do people learn history and not from history?
Well, I would say there are two things there. There is a not learning, and then there's not taking action. Because one could conceivably learn and then be too passive to take action. But no, this is something historians bang their heads against the wall about all the time. I mean, history never tells you what will happen. History tells you what can happen. You know, in that sense, it kind of fuels one's neuroses because you have a sense of the possibilities. They're generally much more expansive than people believe them to be because we have a natural human tendency to normalize the abnormal. You know, we have a natural human tendency to keep going as if everything is okay until it's not. You know, and what we do learn from history is that people will keep going through their daily routine as if everything were okay, basically until they're in the gas chambers.
Right.
Like much longer than you would ever think. There's this beautiful poem by Czesław Miłosz, or he described, it's called in English, a song about the end of the world. And he writes about how, you know, on the days the world is ending, the dolphins will still be swimming and people will still be walking down the street. And people who were waiting for fire and brimstone and thunder are going to be disappointed because there will be no other end of the world. The end of the world is coming in this very ordinary way. And I can't shake that poem out of my, I love Polish poetry, but that's not the only right. Like since November 5th, I have not been able to shake that poem out of my head, especially looking, and I'm in Toronto now, so I'm not even in the States. I was there last week, but I'm not there at the moment. And I see that the reaction is muted in comparison to 2016, even as the catastrophe seems much more decisive.
Yeah.
Like Trump clearly has a lot more power now. He's a lot stronger. Whatever we were calling guardrails have been dismantled. All of these vestiges of the rule of law have been taken apart. Of all the catastrophic things that happened in a 1 month period this summer, I thought the most catastrophic was the Supreme Court ruling of immunity. I mean, all of these things, I mean, the things that were unimaginable. I mean, it turns out you can incite a violent insurrection, that you can approve the hanging of your vice president, all of them in full public view, and nothing will happen to you, that you've been declared untouchable. And so it seems that it feels much more decisive now. I feel much more like I'm saying goodbye to America. Yeah. And yet the reaction is much more muted.
Yeah, thank you for that. My first headline when Roe was overturned was "Birds Still Sing Under Fascism," because I could hear the birds outside my window singing away, And yet everything had changed. And thank you so much for all the poetry in your book. It is all so beautiful. I'm going to have to learn more languages. You have a very important point in your Ukrainian Night where you talk about reality television has done away with the distinction between the fictional and the real. And that is kind of the core of our show. And is there anything we can do mobilizing people to reverse that? Because without reality and without truth, we are just, you know, witnessing the end of the world.
So one of the you know, heroes or protagonist of that book is Yurko Prohasko, who is a literary translator, Ukrainian literary translator and psychoanalyst. And when Peter Pomerantsev's book came out in 2015, we did a public talk in Kiev on the book, Nothing is True and Everything is Possible, his book about post-truth in Putin's Russia, which I thought was brilliant. I mean, it reads as if very chatty and gossipy and colorful, which it is, but between the lines, it was, at the moment it came out, the most philosophically penetrating book about post-truth to be produced that early. And one of the things that Yurko said is that your truth is a limit. Truth is a constraint. You know, when you take that away, then you're into this anything is possible, you know, type of world. You know, when we get rid of those barriers, when we get rid of those constraints. And I think on one hand, that's been a huge amount of Trump's appeal. I mean, I teach intellectual history, so I would go back to Freud and Freud, Civilization and Its Discontents. Freud says civilization is based on repression. Really, you know, we would like to rape and kill one another all the time, but we have to repress those desires because that's not really functional to live together. And if you take away those constraints and say, okay, now everything is permissible, that is real liberation. And for that, Freud says, we pay the small price of the destruction of civilization, which we are now watching. You know, and so, you know, truth is one of those things that constrains, it represses, it sets limits. You know, and you take that away and say, well, you have your truth, I have my truth, and maybe it's kind of true. And, you know, we're all used to this world in which, well, half of it's staged, but a little bit of it's true, and nobody really cares about the boundary anymore. That's a very dangerous place to put ourselves in because it's a taking away of any kind of constraint. It's a taking away of any kind of boundary, which has been, I mean, for me, conceptually, it's been the most interesting, you know, and terrifying thing that is part of what I would call neo-totalitarianism. There's been a big discussion that a lot of people have been involved with, you know, including Masha Gessen, about, you know, what is the same and what is different. You know, for those of us who have spent a lot of time studying Nazism, studying Stalinism, studying how totalitarian ideology works, how fascist ideology works, what is different about post-truth? You know, and I think a lot of things are similar, but a lot of things really are different because ideology really tried to tell a single coherent story. You know, the story was a lie. It was based on falsehoods, but there was a demand that it go together in a kind of seamless way, so that internal to itself, things made sense. You know, and now we're in a world where, you know, Putin can say one day, well, this is a preemptive attack because NATO was plotting to invade Russia. Well, there were Ukrainian Nazis that were plotting to massacre all the native Russian speakers. Well, we are, you know, we need to restore the lands of Peter the Great. Well, it can be, well, actually, they're not Nazis, they're Satanists, and we have to rid Kiev of this cult. I mean, he can tell a different story every day, and there's no demand that there be any kind of consistency. You know, and you work on people so that they give up even thinking that truth exists or that it matters. And that is something different. This kind of postmodern totalitarianism is different. You know, and this is, you know, Trump comes on the scene, and the New Yorker had this very, very amusing but also serious satire still during, I think, the Republican primary debates before he was even chosen as a candidate, about the fact checker who passes out from exhaustion, you know, at the end of the primary debate. Because it's, you know, fact checkers were used to, well, you know, you guys are reporters, like, fact checking individual facts. You know, what happens when you have a total unhinging from empirical reality? Nobody can fact check fast enough to come up with these, you know, one fantasy world. Okay, I spun that. I threw it out. Today there's another fantasy world. Or an hour later, there's another fantasy world.
Thank you so much for that. That is our dilemma. And my last question for you is, can America have a Majdan, or are we just going to be looking at our democracy and our country and all the freedoms we've enjoyed in the rear view mirror?
I think it's always possible. It's what fascinates me. One of the many things that fascinate me about revolution is that you never really know when you get that mysterious cocktail of elements that will produce a tipping point. My kids ask about this all the time. You need a critical mass of people at the same time with a clarity about values, willing to cross to the other side of fear at the same time. And then what you really need are people from the security apparatus to defect. Now, what produces that cocktail of energy, of solidarity, of courage, and makes it come together? And what pushes the tipping point? Like, I watched Belarus in August 2020, and I was absolutely convinced that they had it. I thought, they've got that critical mass. There are people being incredibly brave, like that nobody believes in Lukashenko anymore. When the workers were also his base of support, when they were yelling, you know, go away, I thought, it's over. You know, and then Putin comes in and buys off the security apparatus and reinforces them with weapons, you know, and more thugs. And I really thought they had it. Like, it seems to me that Georgians should have it. That is a small country, and they have a huge percentage of the population on the streets. After the full-scale invasion of Ukraine, I was talking to one of my Ukrainian colleagues who's based in Washington, and I said, Vlad, what would it take for there to be a revolution in Russia to bring down Putin's regime? And he said, 2 million people in the streets of Moscow, it's over tomorrow. I said, Vlad, how do you know it's 2 million? Is 1.9 million not enough? Like, when is it that one additional person? There's always some mystical moment when it's that one additional person. You know, and what is that cocktail that produces that? You know, and that to some extent is in the realm of the spontaneous. And think about Romania. Think about, Bucharest, Ceausescu in December 1989. That regime was brutal. They had crushed everybody. You know, and suddenly there's the rally of support for Ceausescu and the one guy who starts shouting boo. And just at that moment, the people around him catch on. They cross to the other side of fear. You know, and suddenly, after decades of brutal repression, it's over in the next 20 minutes. And you think, maybe that guy would have been standing at another part of the crowd and the people around him would not have caught on, or they would have been afraid. And there's always these elements of radical contingency that make it very, very hard to predict. But I do think there's always hope, even in places you wouldn't necessarily expect. I mean, for me, what I cling to, you know, the story of the Majdan, which was so important to me at the time, and if anything, is only more important now. I kind of cling to it still more desperately now, because it was that, what in German they call that Augenblick, that like that blink of an eye, that flicker of a second in which you see that human beings are capable of something better. Even if that rarely happens, even if that kind of solidarity and courage and clarity about truth and dignity and responsibility, even if it's there for a flicker of a second and then it's gone, the fact that it can be there for even the flicker of a second is proof that we are capable of it. And I cling to that now. I have to.
Marci, sure. Thank you so much. America, if you're listening, let's cross to the other side of fear together. Thank you so much for that brilliant interview. We are so indebted to you. We hope you come back. We hope to be documenting this history, this historic moment together. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me. I hope we have better news next time to talk about.
Absolutely. Me as well. Thank you so much.